Hi, thank you for welcoming me. Thank you for having me today. I'm just going to share my screen so I can present you the presentation. I hope you all see it correctly. So today, like Alexandre said, I'm going to talk about the rights of children in the Youth Protection Act. And I know I have a short time, so I'm sorry if I go fast and maybe some of the slides I go a bit faster because I want to make sure I present everything, but you will get the presentation so you can really have all the information in detail. And like Alexandre said, you can always ask questions. And I do offer more in-depth training session and workshop if ever you are interested or you want to offer it to the team. It will be my pleasure. So the Youth Protection Act was adopted in 1977 and came into force in 1979. So it's been more than 40 years that we have the Youth Protection Act and therefore the Director of Youth Protection, the DYP, because it was this act that created the DYP. This act is for any children in the territory of Quebec whose security or development is or might be in danger. And this is as of November 30th, 2021, so today. It is an act that's provincial. So each province in Canada has their own version, if you want, which can be similar, but there are differences in each provinces. And something interesting is that with the Youth Protection Act, it changed the status, the legal status of children. So before 1979, children were object of rights. And with the Youth Protection Act, we did recognize that children were subjects of right. So they're not the property of their parents. They are a human being and are the subject of their own rights. And this is why when we're in youth protection, children have their own lawyers. So parents will have their lawyer, but children will also have their own lawyer to defend their own interests and rights. Some key element in the Youth Protection Act that I wanted to share with you. So the act is very clear that parents are primarily responsible for their children. It's section 2.2 of the Youth Protection Act. The aim of the Youth Protection Act is to put an end to the situation that endangers the child's security and or development. What this means is that it is not a prevention act, if you want. Like this is not a law kind of in prevention. It's really that when there's a situation of crisis that the DYP is supposed to get involved. So it should never be the first intervention. This is not how the Youth Protection Act was created. This is not why. We must try to keep the child in his or her family environment. So this is section 4 of the Youth Protection Act. And I want to go a bit further with that. Actually, that it says you have to take all the measure to try as much as possible so that the child can stay with the parents. And if it's not possible, there's an obligation to look around the family in the larger network, the extended family, but also the community, if there's someone that can take care of the child to kind of prevent that the child lose all the connection and the relation in his life or her life. And finally, we have to take into account the child's characteristic, which can mean the age, the vulnerability of the child, but also his or her cultural communities. What this means is that you cannot have an intervention that is provided the same way for all the children. It has to be kind of customized to the needs of each children. And this is important. You know, it's not the responsibility of the child to kind of adapt or be able to understand if something is said to him or her. It is the responsibility of the workers to kind of adapt the intervention to the need of that child. So those are some of the rights that are presented in the Youth Protection Act, and I'm going to go deeper into most of them, but I wanted to kind of give you an overview. So children, it's the section 5, 6, and 7 in the Youth Protection Act, have the right to be informed, heard, and consulted. Children have the right to consult a lawyer. They have the right to be prepared when transferring from one alternative living environment to another. They have the right to adequate, continuous, and personalized services. The right to be accompanied by the person of his or her choice. The right to communicate in a confidential manner. Rights when there's discipline measure that are applied during a placement. And finally, also, they have rights to be placed in a premise that is appropriate to their needs. So we're going to go deeper into those rights. I also wanted to touch about the Youth Criminal Justice Act to say that if a young person is under the YCJA, they also have the rights. And it's very clear in the Youth Protection Act that Section 7 to 10 also apply for a young person that would be in care, but regarding to the YCJA. Okay, so I just wanted to kind of present that it's not because they're not under the Youth Protection Act that they don't have rights. So the first one that I wanted to present was Section 7, which are the rights of a child when they're transferred between alternative living. So that's very important because it's not when the child is, for example, moved from his or her parents to another living. It's really when we move them from one alternative living to another one, okay? So it's really, the Section 7 really apply in those specific situation. And there are like three category of rights, if you want. The first one is the child, the parents, and the alternative living environment have the right to be consulted. What does it mean to be consulted? First of all, it means that it has to be done before the transfer. Okay, you cannot be consulted for something that has already happened. So it's not necessarily about the decision to be transferred, but it's more about how it will be done. So it can be about the modality, how we can prepare. And also you want to consult the child or the parents and also the alternative living it can help the worker to maybe choose the next living environment that would be the most adequate or appropriate for the child. So I have seen situation when a child, the child was consulted and he said that he would like to be in a foster family that would be closer to his mom. So that was something. And then so the worker could take that into consideration, you know, like to be like, this is something that would be important for the child. When we talk about the child alternative living environment that will be consulted, most of the time it will be more on when to inform the child about that decision, and also like what would be important in the next environment. So what we've seen is maybe a foster family that could say that it would be very important to find another living environment that would be very structured because that child has special needs for that. Or you could also have a family that could say that next week, for example, the child has exam at school and is very stressed. So it wouldn't be the right time to kind of inform the child about the transfer, you know, so maybe just wait one more week. So it's more how it will be done. The second right is the right to be informed. And this is the right of the child and the parent. And what's important about that is that the child must receive the information that's necessary for his or her transfer. And they have to understand the information. So simply telling the child information is not enough. It has to be done. You have to ensure that the child understands the information. So it has to be adapted to the level of comprehension of the child and also for the parents. And the final rights that's under that section is the right of the child to be prepared. And it means that it has to be a preparation that's necessary for the child. So it cannot be, like I said in the previous slide, it cannot be a uniform preparation for every children that will be transferred. You know, so each child will have different needs. And you have to adapt the preparation depending on the needs. So we will consider that a child has been well prepared if it meets the needs of that child, if the child feel comfortable with, well, as much as possible with the transfer. So for example, for one child, it could need to talk to the next living environment. So maybe the foster family or the care unit. Maybe it would go visit, maybe have one meal with the next living environment to kind of adapt, maybe have also an outing or spend maybe a weekend before fully transferring. So what's important is really to kind of personalize that preparation. Section 8, so those are the right of the child for social, health, and educational services. And the child has the right to receive adequate and continuous service. You have to take into account the available resources, so human, financial. But what's important is that when it says that you have to take into account the resources, it is not a reason to not offer the service. So it can kind of justify adapting the services, maybe modulating it, offering a comparable service, or maybe playing with the frequency of the service that will be offered. But you cannot justify that to not provide a service. The second thing that I wanted to talk when we talk about services is that when services are the result of a court order, so for example, the court order, a psychological evaluation, the obligation to offer the service goes further, and the decision is enforceable at the time that it is made, so at the time of the court order. But just because it's not ordered doesn't mean that it should not be given. So if to kind of ensure that the situation of compromission is stopped, then the child needs to receive a service, then there's an obligation to offer that service. And even if it's in a voluntary measure with the DYP, it could also be considered a breach of agreement. So if one of the service was agreed under a voluntary measure and the DYP does not offer the service, then we could consider that they're not respecting the rights of the child to receive adequate services. So this is for, and when I talk social services, I talk health services and also educational services. So because a child is under care, doesn't mean that he or she shouldn't have, access to education as all the children. You know, it shouldn't justify if a child is in a readaptation center, for example, to not have access to school for a couple of weeks or months. You know, it's not a reason for that. Section 8 is a big section because it also has the right of the child and the parents to be accompanied. So the right to be accompanied, it's a right that belongs to the child. And also the parents have the right to be accompanied. It says clearly in the section that it's by the person of his or her choice. So it doesn't say by the adult of the choice. So we could think, and there would be no reason why a child couldn't be accompanied, for example, by his or her sister or brother, or someone else in the community that's not necessarily an adult, but that is a significant person for that child. The right to be accompanied is in very specific situation. It's when they wish to obtain information or when they meet the DYP or the representative, so the workers. So it's not in all situation. So for example, if there's a supervised contact with parents and children and the parents want to be accompanied by someone, it can be allowed, but the right to be accompanied doesn't play in that situation, you know. So because it's a clinical element, so it's a time for the parents to spend time with their children. It doesn't go into the category that they have the right to be accompanied. And the last thing I wanted to say to be really clear is that if, for example, a parent want to accompany their child, they can, but it's not their right. It's not the right of the parents to accompany their child when the child is meeting, for example, the worker. So if the child doesn't want to be accompanied by the parent and wants to be accompanied by his uncle or her grandmother, then it is the person that the child wants that will accompany the child. Section nine is the right of children to communicate in a confidential manner. Once again, that section is very specific when a child is in alternative living arrangement. So it's not when when they're with their parents. It's really if they're in a foster family or a readaptation center, for example. And the section is in three categories. So the first category of person that the child can communicate confidentially is with his or her lawyer, the director of youth protection of its region, the court clerks and the commission, so the CDPDG, and there's no limitation possible, okay? So nobody can limit those contact or put supervision on those contact. The second category of people that the child can communicate confidentially are his or her parents, brothers and sister. And it's only the court that can decide otherwise. So the only exception is when the court decide to have supervision or to prohibit those contact, but it's not a social worker that can make that decision. It's not a foster family that can make that decision to supervise the contact. It's only the court that can make that decision. And when we talk about parents, it's very large. So it's biological or adoptive parents, and same for the brothers and sister. It's half brother, half sister. It's we have to understand it in a very large meaning for those categories. The last category of people that the child can communicate confidentially with is any person. So the child is allowed to communicate confidentially with anyone, except if the court decides otherwise. Okay, so it's only the court that can decide otherwise. The reason why it's in a separate category is because if a youth is in residential care, the general director or the authorized person of that care may prohibit such contact, but the decision, and that's very important, has to be reasoned, justified, and has to be given in writing. So even if, for example, a worker say to a young person, you're not allowed to talk to that other person in your life. We don't think it's a good influence for you. And the young person agrees. Even if that young person agrees, what's important is that it has to be justified and it has to be done in writing. And the young person has to be informed that she or he can contest this decision, and it will be taken to the court. Okay, so that young person, if at any point doesn't agree with the decision, can be heard, because it's a very important right, the right to communicate to others, you know. So you cannot just restrict or prohibit that right without justification. Whoops. So that's for section 9. Section 10, so it's the right of children to apply disciplinary measure in a right way, if you want. So it's, once again, it's when a child is in a residential care. Any disciplinary measure must be applied in the best interest of the child and be compliant with internal rules. And those rules must be approved by the institution board of director, have to be displayed in full view of all inside the establishment. They have to be, so those rules have to be explained to children and their parents, and the rules have to be given to the child, to the parents, to the CDPDG, to the commission, and to the Minister of Social Services and Health. And the last thing is that you can never use as a disciplinary measure isolation, intensive supervision, and measure to prevent the child from leaving the establishment. So those measures are really intended to protect the child from him or herself, or to protect others. So it's really when there's a situation in danger that you will use those measures, but it should never be in a disciplinary way that you use those measures. Woo, sorry. Yeah, this happened. So other rights that may be infringed within the meaning of the Youth Protection Act. So what I wanted to say is that the rights are written in the form of principle in Chapter 2 of the Youth Protection Act. So you will see things like the Section 3, the rights of the child to have a decision made under the Youth Protection Act in his or her interest. For that section, it has been amended to specify that for a native child, the preservation of the child cultural identity must be taken into consideration, you know, when we have to make a decision in its best interest, and the right to continuity of care and stability of ties. So for example, Section 4 also specify that if it's not possible to maintain a child from a First Nation in his or her family, the decision must be to place the child in an alternative living environment that is capable of preserving the child's cultural identity, with preference given to a member of the child's extended family, community, or nation. You know, so even if it's not written as a right, it's a principle, but it can be, like, we can consider that those rights are encroached or infringed. And finally, any contravention or non-respect of the Youth Protection Act can be considered as an encroachment of the right of the child. So for example, non-compliance with an order, so Section 93, or there's no regular monitoring in the child's living environment, which is Section 69, those could be reason also to consider that the rights of the child are not respected. I think I managed to go through my presentation.
Thank you, Alexa. So, Alexa, good morning, everyone. So, as Alex said, my name is Cedric Gray-Lahou. I'm the Justice Initiatives Advisor at the Commission, and I'm Mi'kmaq from the community of Listigage, here today to present what is commonly known as C92. I will share my screen. There we go. So today is just a quick presentation to give you an overview of the Act Respecting First Nations, Inuit, and Métis Children, Youth, and Families, and see how it might interact with what was just said by the CDPDG, but also with the current Youth Protection Act under Quebec. So to get there, we're going to go through the steps taken, give you a bit of context on what brought us to this place today, and then we're going to go through the Act, see what it represents, and also the different principles that apply right now today. So for a bit of context, the Truth and Reconciliation Commission enacted different calls to justice, and the fourth one talks about creating a national principle on youth protection for First Nations children in care. So with this as a background, but with other things that happened, an emergency meeting was held in Ottawa on January 25th and 26th of 2018, where different representatives from the federal, provincial, territorial governments, but also from different First Nations, Inuit, and Métis leaders, elders, youth, community service workers, and organizations all got together to say, well, if we were to respond to Call to Action 4, what would it look like? What would this national basic First Nations Child and Family Services law look like? On top of that, there were different consultations that took place all across the country, again with First Nations, Inuit, and Métis organizations, to really say locally, what would your law have to include? And all of this brought us to an Act Respecting First Nations, Inuit, and Métis Children, Youth, and Families, which I will be referring to as C-92 just to save on time. So what does C-92 do after all these consultations? Well, it does three main things. The first one is that it affirms the jurisdiction of First Nations and Inuit authorities in matters of child and family services. One of the big distinctions with C-92 versus different mechanisms that do exist in the Youth Protection Act here in Quebec is that Canada is recognizing under Section 35 of the Constitution that we as Indigenous peoples have the jurisdiction in matters of child and family services. They are not delegating authorities, but recognizing and affirming that these authorities exist. The second thing that is done with C-92 is creating different national principles which apply to our children. So the principles in C-92 are in addition to those provided under the provincial law concerning child and family services. And in our next slide, we'll see how that works. How can two different laws with similar principles work together? And finally, the third point is that it contributes to the implementation of the United Nations Declaration of the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. This is something with another law that was passed by the federal government, which is actively trying to be done by the federal government, is really recognizing the UNDRIP declaration. So I said we'd get into seeing how all of this works together. We have three different periods of time. We have prior to January 1st, 2020, which is when the law came into effect. We have what's happening today, so what's already in effect. And then we have what's going to happen, what can be. So if we look at our first category, prior to January 1st, 2020, the Youth Protection Act applies to the communities. That was it. That was as simple as it was. Youth Protection Act applied in all of our communities, even though we were federal territory. This was because there were no national standards, which was one of the recommendations, right, by the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. One of the things we have to say is there's certain particularities, and that's where you see the asterisks, where le Conseil de la Nation Atikamekw had signed an agreement to create their own special youth protection program under the 37.5 agreements. But again, while this allowed the SNA to enact their own interpretation of the law, they were still applying the Quebec law. After January 1st, 2020, what's already in effect, and it's important to say here, you might have heard that Quebec is contesting or challenging the law in court, saying that the federal government did not have the jurisdiction to even legislate on this. Even if that's happening, yes, there is a court case. These principles still do apply. They are in effect. The law is the law as it stands right now. So what happens then in that case and already in effect? Well, the Youth Protection Act still applies to our communities. because we don't have anything else. We have principles, but we don't have specific laws to cover all aspects of the youth protection. So the Youth Protection Act will still apply and still does apply in our communities. However, the big change is that the principles from the federal law, which I will be presenting after, also apply to communities. So what we're looking at here is a system in which the Youth Protection Act applies as a whole, but if there are principles that are the same, then the federal definition of it is the one that must be applied. It must be interpreted. And this stands with all decisions that come from intervention workers, caseworkers, but also the court systems. So it's important as a First Nations person that if ever one of your clients or one of your family members is in a youth protection case, to ask for the principles of C-92 to be applied. Quebec hasn't necessarily been the best of partners in implementing this in their systems, but again, there is a court challenge, so it's up to us to push for it and to make sure that these principles are respected. The law is a law, and right now C-92 does apply. And finally, in our long-term category, so what does C-92 do? It affirms the jurisdiction of First Nations people with regards to youth protection. This means that First Nations people can enact their own law under this federal law. Their right is recognized, so they can create their own Youth Protection Act, which belongs to their community, to the nation, to a group of communities, etc. This new law, once it's enacted, and again, it will take about, at the very least, 1 year, but it can be longer than that, and we'll get into this a bit later. A First Nations law can completely replace the Youth Protection Act here in Quebec. Or if a community, nation, group chooses, it can cover a part of the Youth Protection Act, and XYZ of the Youth Protection Act can also apply within the community. It's really up to the community, nation, or group to choose how far they want to go. Within this law, though, you do have to apply the federal principles. These federal principles are ones that come from a national consultation that we talked about earlier, from the emergency meeting. So they were co-created by First Nations people. And as you'll see, they're really based in prevention, they're based in culture, they're based in recognition of our capacities. So you have to apply them, but at the same time, at least you're applying a First Nations oriented principle. And finally, like I said, well, the Youth Protection Act can still apply to your community, depending on the law you enacted. And again, it's your own law, so if you want to start small and build up your capacity as you build up your law, that is also something that can be done. So if we get into the principles, quick reminder, these principles are the ones that must be interpreted for caseworkers, but also the court systems. So really, these do apply today. If there's one thing you can leave with today, these apply. Ask for these to be the ones that are used whenever there's a case with a First Nations child. Our first principle is cultural continuity. And this is a principle that's not found in the Youth Protection Act. We basically start setting the ground on how do we work with First Nations youth during a youth protection file. We come say in paragraph A that cultural continuity is essential to the well-being of a child. So already placing culture as part of the well-being of the child. We come define it in paragraph B. So the transmission of languages, cultures, practices, customs, traditions, ceremonies, and knowledge are integral to cultural continuity. We come then define it a bit further in saying that a child's best interests are often promoted when the child resides with members of his or her family and the culture of the indigenous group, community, or people to which he or she belongs, reinforcing the aspect that the best way to have access to your culture is to be within your culture. In paragraph D, we say that whatever system is created, we do not contribute to the assimilation of the indigenous group. We don't want to recreate a system of residential schools, of 60 Scoop, or of any of the institutions that were there that assimilated First Nations children. And finally, in paragraph E, we have something that's also new to the interpretation of Youth Protection Act, where we say the characteristics and challenges of the region in which a child, family, or indigenous group, community, or people are located are to be considered. So the realities of an urban population cannot be the same as an isolated population. So whenever a decision is being made, with regards to the best interests of the child, with regards to youth protection and prevention, we must take into consideration the realities of the region before making a decision. So really trying to create a system in which the realities of the child and where they are taken into consideration. Our second principle is substantive equality. Substantive equality is something that's, again, not found in the Youth Protection Act. So this principle will apply and adds itself to the YPA with our current system. And what we say is that the rights and needs and distinct needs of a child with a disability are to be considered in order to promote the child's participation to the same extent as other children in the activities of his or her family or Indigenous group, community, people. So what we're saying here is that we have to make sure that whenever services are offered, whenever an event is being held, that a child will not be faced with things that make them unable to participate. A community, a group, an institution must do everything it can to ensure that the child has the same access as all other children would have. In paragraph B, C, and D, we basically do the same thing. The B will be for the child, C will be for the parents, and D will be for the Indigenous governing body, where they must be able to exercise his or her rights under this act without any discrimination. So this is something that already exists in the Youth Protection Act, and it was just to reinforce it. This is for everyone. They must be able to exercise his or her rights, what we heard under Loelia's presentation. And finally, in paragraph E, we talk about in order to promote substantive equality between Indigenous children and other children, a jurisdictional dispute must not result in a gap in the child and family services that are provided in relation to Indigenous children. So here, without naming it, we are talking about Jordan's principle. We're saying that a jurisdictional dispute, whether it be, is Quebec going to pay or is the federal going to pay, that can't result in the child not receiving funds or care. So the first person who you go see must cover the bill, and then they can discuss it between themselves to see who will reimburse who. But as long as the child has received the services after the first request, that's really what the important part is. This is something that at the commission we have a Jordan's principal advisor. And again, in your community, there's people who can help you with these kinds of things. If we get into the big part of C92, and this is really something in which the Youth Protection Act does have a principle on the best interests of a child, but it is very limited. What we do here with C92 is we develop it and we really bring in cultural considerations throughout the whole point. So if there's one principle that you should remember, this is the biggest one. We start talking about in this first paragraph about how the best interest of the child is the primary consideration in the making of or taking of decisions, and how everything that is done must be based on this. If we go to paragraph two, we start saying that when we go to subsection three, which is the next one are being considered, primary consideration must be given to the child's physical, emotional, and psychological safety, security, and well-being. So that's how the Youth Protection Act functions. Those are the primordial things on which you base yourself. However, what we do in C92 is we add, as well as to the importance for that child of having an ongoing relationship with his or her family and with the Indigenous group, community, or people to which he or she belongs, and of preserving the child's connection to his or her culture. So whereas the Youth Protection Act talks about physical, emotional, psychological well-being, C92 comes add on the other side of the balance saying, yeah, but culture is also one of the most important things. So when a decision is made, it's got to be balanced. The child has to have access to his or her culture, but also their security and well-being must be taken into consideration. Like I said, one of the big differences with C92 is that culture is seen as being an integral part of the well-being of the child and can be separated. So we just really have to work with that relationship, as both are as important, one as the other. Here, we're gonna go quickly through it because it does resemble a lot what was done in the Youth Protection Act. So we start determining what are the factors. So we talk about their upbringing, we talk about their needs for stability, we talk about the relationship with the parents or the care provider, which is one of the big changes in Senate N2. where we recognize that a child is not only raised by their parents in First Nations communities. Grandma, grandpa, auntie, uncle all have an important part to play and may be significant people for the child. So the care provider does open up the definition of who is responsible for a child within C92. In paragraph D, we talk about the child's cultural identity in connection to the language and territory. We talked about it earlier. Being with your own people is one of the most important things for your well-being. Paragraph E, we look at the views and preference of the child. Loelia went over that quite a bit. But one of the main points is with F. And this is a major change within the interpretation of First Nations care. So any plans for the child's care, including care in accordance with the customs or traditions of the Indigenous group, community, or the people to which a child belongs, have to be considered. So what we're saying here is that we now recognize legally and within the law the care that is given within cultural or traditional ways. So this can be going out onto the land, this can be participating in sweats, participating in ceremonies, all these things which were generally pushed aside by the court systems, by intervention workers, with the Youth Protection Act, now must be considered as proper care. You don't necessarily have to be going to a psychiatrist, a psychologist, because maybe our spiritual leader is giving you even more wellness. It doesn't say you have to be only one or the other, but both have to be considered now. And finally, G, family violence or criminal proceeding are stuff that also existed in the Youth Protection Act. Another principle, which is a major shift from the Youth Protection Act, is the priority to preventive care. So in this, we're really where Loelia said it earlier, the Youth Protection Act is a protection law. We're starting to make C92 something of protection, but also mostly prevention. How can we break the cycles and how can we offer the services and assistance that a family needs to help them get out of their situation and offer the best support to their child? So in section 14.1, we talk to the extent that providing a service that promotes preventive care to support the child's family is consistent with the best interest of the child. The provision of that service is to be given priority over other services. So before withdrawing a child, and again, within the interest of the child that we just defined, we have to make sure to offer the services the family needs, that the child needs, before taking that child and placing him into custody. The second one is prenatal care. And that's where we say, will be in the best interest of an Indigenous child after he or she is born. The provision of that service is to be given priority over other services in order to prevent the apprehension of the child at the time of the child's birth. So in paragraph 2 in prenatal care, what we're saying here is we want to break the cycle and we want to stop the intervention of what is known as birth alerts. Quebec has its own thought on this, but it still exists in our province. It has been happening in certain regions more so than others. But what we're saying here in principle 14, paragraph 2, or section 14, paragraph 2, is that priority must be given to prevention services before we go towards apprehending a child at birth. One of the final principles is socioeconomic conditions. And this, again, is a principle that's not found in the Youth Protection Act. And it's where we say that the child must not be apprehended solely on the basis of his or her socioeconomic conditions. And the magical word here is including, but not limited to. So including, we're starting a list, but it might be defined further by your own laws in your communities. We talk about poverty, we talk about lack of adequate housing or infrastructure, or the state of health of his or her parents or the care provider. So again, we know there are issues with housing, overpopulation in our housing. We know there are issues with access to employment, which lead to poverty within our communities. There's a whole socio-historical background to that. But what we're saying here is that a child cannot be apprehended because of these reasons. If there are three or four kids in a room, well, what can the community offer as an additional service to ensure that the child is not placed into a dangerous situation, but also maintains that link with their family? We're trying to break the cycle of a First Nations child being discriminated against for socio-historical context that is not his or her fault. we're trying to break that cycle of incarceration, trying to break that cycle of representation within the youth protection system by making sure that the socioeconomic conditions are not reasons for which a child is taken. And one of the final, principle that we wanted to present was placement of an Indigenous child. So this is a principle that is found in the Youth Protection Act. Loya mentioned it earlier. However, what C92 does is come create an order of priority. So what we're saying here is that whenever a child is placed in the Child and Family Services, the placement has to occur within this order, within the best interest of the child. So really we go at your first choice, it has to be with one of the child's parents. If the child is with their mother, can they go to their father? If with their father, can they go to their mother? In paragraph B, we talk about another adult member of the child's family. So as we mentioned earlier, grandma, grandpa, auntie, uncle, big brother, big sister, whoever it is, but is there someone within their family that can take care of the child? If no, we go on to paragraph C. So with an adult who belongs to the same Indigenous group, community, or people as the child. Here we're really talking about maintaining that link with the community. So is it a neighbor? Is it someone else from the community just an hour away? Is there another group that is similar to ours or within ours that can take care of the child? And if not, well, are there other Indigenous groups that could? So instead of sending your Innu child into an Innu community, can they go to a Wendat community? Can they go into a Mi'kmaq community? And those kinds of things. And if all this doesn't work, then we go on to paragraph E with any other adult. So we're mostly talking about non-Indigenous people here. The one nuance I want to place is that this is within the best interest of the child. So for an urban community who's right next to a town, a city, or whatever, if the child A, B, C, or D don't work, it might be in the best interest of the child to keep him close, but be in a non-Indigenous family, so that the access to the family, access to the culture of his own community is easily accessible versus sending the child to another community an hour away. So it's something that must be argued and something that must be proven within the best interest of the child, but it can be done if that's how it should be interpreted. And for my part, that is the quick run through of the principles and of C92 and how it applies. And I will pass you back to Alexandre Bacon. Thank you, Alexandre.
Thank you very much. I'm just gonna share my screen. So like Alexandre said, I'm gonna present to you the process if you wanna make an intervention request at the commission regarding the rights of a child in youth protection. Quickly, the commission has two big mandates, one regarding the Charter of Human Rights and Freedom, and we can do service for employer, advisory service, and we can investigate regarding human rights. So there's 14 prohibited grounds of discrimination, and we do investigate in that, but we also have a mandate by the Youth Protection Act to protect the child's interest and rights. And we can investigate under, so very specifically under the Youth Protection Act. Our mandate under the Youth Protection Act, like I said, is to promote and respect the rights of children, to investigate situation when we have reason to believe that a child's rights are being violated. We can take, so the commission can take legal measure if we think that it's necessary to correct a situation where the child's rights are being violated or we think they're being violated. We have a responsibility to develop and implement education program on children's rights. We can make recommendation to the government under an investigation. So if at the end of an investigation, we think that it's necessary to make recommendation to the government to make change, but we can at any time make recommendation if there's a situation that we're concerned. And we can also do research or social study regarding the rights of children in youth protection. So the intervention request to the commission, specifically regarding the rights of children in youth protection. So the first thing that's really important is that it can be done by anyone for the child interests. So the grandparents, the extended family, the neighbors, foster family, professionals that are concerned for the children, or the child itself can contact the commission saying that they think that the rights of the child are not being respected. So really anyone can make a request to the commission if they're concerned. The second thing is that the requests are confidential. So the commission will never say who is making the request. There are no monetary corrective measure. I do mention it because in the charter side of the commission, if there is discrimination, there can be a monetary measure, so a compensation. But if the rights of a child are not being respected, it's not going to be like there's going to be measure put into place, but it's never going to be a monetary measure. And something really important, I think, is that there are no stated of limitation. So there's no time limit to file an application. So if you think at any point that the rights of a child have not been respected, you can always make a request to the commission. It is possible if it's been a long time and the file do not exist anymore. So if, for example, if an adult consult the commission and say, when I was 12 year old, my rights were not being respected, we're gonna investigate, but it's possible that if the youth protection file does not exist, we're not gonna be able necessarily to complete the investigation, but we will look into it. So there's no deadline. The commission does not act as the child prosecutor. Okay, so we're not there as the child prosecutor, and the investigator will not advocate for the child. We're there to ensure that the rights of the children are being respected. Our investigation powers, so we have the same powers as those that are granted under the Act Respecting Public Inquiry Commission. So like commissioners, investigator. So what kind of powers do we have? So the commission can interview any person that can give important information about the request. So it's always within the object of the request. But if we want to talk to a doctor or a police officer regarding a situation, we have the rights and the power to interview that person. We can ask and obtain information, documents, and we can visit the premises. So we're gonna see that a lot if, for example, we've been informed of a situation of isolation, and we want to make sure that the place where the child was being held, for example, respected the rights of that child. So we can go and visit and physically make sure that it was an adequate place for that child. The process, so the steps for a request. The first step is reception and assessment. So we're going to receive and process requests. We do receive a lot of demand that are more regarding information. Some people, when they contact the commission, they actually want to report a situation where a child is in danger. So we will refer to the DYP of the region or the authority necessary. We will ensure that we have the competence. We have situation that people will contact us because they're not agreeing with a court order, and this is not the competence of the commission. So if the request is admissible, then we will open a file. Our second step in the process is that we will start the investigation with an evaluation. We will contact the respondent. The respondent is the person or the establishment that could possibly not have respected the child, the rights of the child. So we'll contact the respondent and then we will request information and document. And in a lot of cases, after we receive the information, most of the time we can agree on settlement with the respondent. So either because when we receive the information, we have no more reason to think that the rights of the child are being encroached, or measures have already been taken, put into place by the respondent, or they agree to put into place, like they will give us measures that they will put into place. So at that point, we don't have any reason to go further. There are investigation that we will continue. We will go further if you want. And in that point, the investigator will draft a factual presentation, which will be sent to all the parties in the investigation. All the parties mean the DYP, the respondent, the parents, and the child, if they can have that information, they can understand that information. We will analyze all the evidence. The investigator will analyze the evidence and will prepare a final report. That final report is only for the investigation committee. So the investigation committee is composed of members of the CDPDJ. They are nominated by the National Assembly. They're expert in their own field, so in all different fields. And they will review all the findings and all the evidence that are presented by investigator. And it's the investigation committee that will make a decision if they think or not that the rights of the child are being respected. If they do think that there are rights encroachment, it is the committee that will make recommendation. And then the investigator will do a follow-up of the recommendation to ensure that they are being applied. So I have two examples. Those are a fictional example, but to kind of give you a better understanding of the process and what the commission could put into place. So this would be an example with an agreement. So the intervention we request that we could have would be a 14-year-old Anishinaabe girl is living in a rehabilitation center, despite several requests from the youth to participate in outings and cultural activities organized by her Native Friendship Center in her region and her community. Nothing is being organized by her counselor because the counselor is currently on sick leave and the other workers are overloaded and they do not have the time to take the necessary step to ensure that she can attend the outings. So this is the information that we receive, the commission, and then we will investigate. And at the investigation, it does reveal that no steps have been taken by the rehabilitation center to allow the girl to take part in activities with the Native Friendship Center or her community, nor were any measures taken to ensure the young person cultural continuity, like Cédric talked. So we realize that nothing has been put into place. The resolution in a file like this that we could have, so following our intervention, the DYP undertook to meet with the Native Friendship Center, establish a cooperation agreement to allow the young person to participate in the center's activity. And in addition, a directive was written by the DYP, a presentation was made to all the teams regarding the rights of young people to have outings, cultural activities, especially for young people from First Nation communities. So that could be an example with an agreement. So the measure were put into place. And an example of an investigation with recommendation from the investigation committee. So you would have a request, a 5-year-old girl from an Inuit nation that has been in a non-native foster family for 6 months in another region. The child was placed in this family because she has special needs and requires a lot of support. Contact between the grandparents and their granddaughter are being refused without any reason by the social worker of the Director of Youth Protection. So when we receive that request, we do an investigation, and during the investigation, it does show that the child's rights are not being respected. The DYP names that there's a grand distance for the child to travel to provide the contact, and that the DYP doesn't have any staff to accompany the child for those contacts. The commission also notes, when we're looking into it, that the DYP did not inform the person responsible for youth protection services in the community of the hearings at the court for that little girl. So when the file goes to the investigation committee, the committee concludes that there was reason to believe that the child's rights were not being respected, and recommendations were made to the DYP regarding the importance of ensuring cultural continuity, maintaining ties with her community and her family, as well as the DYP obligation to inform the person responsible for youth protection services in the First Nation community of the hearings. So what was put into place by the DYP after the intervention was an organized schedule of contact between the child and the grandparents, including some contact by video conference due to the distance. So kind of like I said previously, to kind of modulate sometime the situation, if, for example, there's no staff, it's not a justification to not provide contact. An increase of number of transporter for children's travel, so to kind of hire more people to be available for that. And then a directive was put into place, and teams were reminded of the obligation of the DYP to inform the person responsible for the First Nation community of the time, the date, the place, as well as the purpose of the hearings, and the right of that person to attend if they want. So I think I've covered my presentation too.